Without very much further ado, let me welcome you to this co-hosted Academy of Chocolate and Guild of Food Writers events. We have some very illustrious speakers, and two of them are luminaries and, well, still members, of course, of the Guild of Food Writers. Sarah Jane Staines and Sarah Jane Evans, MW. Oh, Sarah Jane Staines is an OBE, so very illustrious. And we have managed to catch between flights and also forced him to miss one, which is just perhaps not so good. It's a rare opportunity. We've managed to catch between flights Frank Homann from Denmark and Copenhagen, who actually initiated the grafting and growing of fine four-flavour cacao. You'd think that was the case worldwide, but believe me, it isn't. You'll hear a great deal about what actually is fine cacao and fine chocolate, and what is run-of-the-mill, and what the differences are, why we should pay more for one rather than the other. There's a whole world to explore, and you've not come here to listen to me, although I'll have to do a little presentation on behalf of someone later. But we'll start with Frank and from Xoco. Frank, do you want to push the arrows yourself, or do you want me to do it? So to the right or to the left. I will look after the lights. Has anybody not had a glass of wine, very importantly, before we start? Anybody without? No? Splendid. Okay. Let's begin.
Yep. All right, so my name is Frank. I am originally from Denmark. We founded a company that started grafting fine cacao 10 years ago in Central America, where we have planted many trees. Cacao is just like any other fruit. Apples, pears, melons. When you go to the supermarket, you will find apples of different color. Why is that?
Different varieties.
Thank you very much. The obvious answer, of course. How does a farmer actually get different varieties? Some of you English people must be have apple trees and stuff like that. How do you preserve, for instance, that there are 4,500 varieties of apples? Did you know that?
Yeah.
So, well, you know, the green ones, one of them is called Granny Smith.
I've been told that every tree that grows from a seed produces a new variety.
That's exactly right. Exactly right. I didn't know that 12 years ago. I had no idea. I mean, trees for me were some green things that out in nature, and I had no idea. But actually, what the gentleman here just said is absolutely correct, that when you plant something by a seed and up comes a new tree, it's a random expression of its ancestry. So even if you take a Granny Smith seed, well, not nowadays because they've been so purified since the day of the Romans, but back then when you started grafting, because that's what they did, Granny Smith trees, and you took a seed from that and you planted it, what would come out is not necessarily a Granny Smith apple. It could be actually a red apple. So planting by seeds is, of course, very easy because you just take the seed, put it into the ground, boom, up comes a new plant, right? Very inexpensive, very easy to do. But that's not how you can preserve one kind of variety, one kind of flavor. And actually, we talked about, I mentioned the Romans, because I recently heard a funny story that the ones who actually invented grafting were the Romans, and the way they invented it was that they found, back then all apple trees were wild apple trees that had been planted by seeds, either on purpose or apples had fallen down on the ground, some animal had eaten them, and somewhere had left the seeds, no? And it was an apple tree. Wild apple trees, apparently back then, the apples didn't taste very good, so nobody ate apples. Romans didn't eat apples. Until one Roman farmer one day plucked down an apple and said, okay, this is actually not a sour tasting apple, it's pretty nice. So what he did is that he took a branch from that apple tree, cut it off, and he simply stuck it onto another apple tree. You have to sort of make a little incision, stick it on, and put something so it holds that new branch onto the tree. And behold, a miracle happens, outgrows a new tree if you're successful in your grafting. And that tree will be an exact copy of that original tree with a good fruit. And that's how the Romans started actually to cultivate apples by grafting. That happened in apples, it happened then in pears, it happened in melons, it happened in all fruit categories except cocoa. Why is that? Any guesses? I didn't know 12 years ago, so if you don't know, don't feel ashamed. But why is it? The Romans didn't know cocoa, and that's actually part of the answer. Part of the answer, because it's grown only in a tropical belt. So in the tropical belts, you have smallholder farmers. Most smallholder farmers have never ever tasted chocolate. Even our farmers, that we'll talk about here in a moment, 80% of them have never even tasted an M&M's or a Mars bar. Right? So it starts with that the people who grow the cacao really don't know what is good and what is not good. And the big advantage of an apple is that if you're a farmer, you can pluck it down, you can taste it, and immediately you know if it's sour and blah, you don't like it, or if it's sweet and tastes good. You don't have to be a culinary expert, right? So, or know what the market, you eat it yourself, you like it. No? What happens with cocoa though is that the farmer cannot really know, because you have to pluck it down. You can't just eat the cocoa like this. You have to take it out of a pot, you have to ferment and dry, and then you have to roast, you have to conch it, you have to add a little bit of sugar, and then you can start actually tasting chocolate, which we will do in a moment. No? And then you can get a feedback, okay, this one is not so good, this other one is good. But that smallholder farmer has no chance of doing that, because just to ferment, you need so much volume to do a good fermentation that no one farmer can do this, one. And number two, as Sarah said here, even if they could do all this, they wouldn't know which one was good and the other one not so good, because they never really tasted chocolate. They'd probably prefer the M&M's. So that's been the problem in cacao, and that's a problem we've tried to solve, being the Romans again. So there's not much more to it. Our company, private company, focused 10 years ago. We are in Honduras. We're in Central America, focused on Central America. Started in Honduras. Expanded a little bit in Nicaragua, long story, and in Guatemala, and now we're in Belize as well. We're starting up projects, and our model has primarily been focused on reproducing the trees in nurseries and getting them out with smallholder farmers, so they would grow them, and then we would, once they started to carry fruit, we would collect the fruit and ferment and dry and sell it on to customers of gourmet chocolate makers like Hotel Michoacán, for example. Present here today, and they would do a good job in their part to do an excellent chocolate. And today we will taste. I was just tasting Emma's chocolate here, and we will taste also Frieshalm with the same bean, actually, different roasting processes. So the roasting among the chocolate maker will also influence a lot on the chocolate. So we planted more than a million trees that are still alive and kicking. Okay, what is a market like? The chocolate market, actually specialty chocolate, is surprisingly, disappointingly low today. It's less than 1% of the market today is actually good chocolate. The rest is sugary stuff that you buy at low prices in the supermarket. And that's very different from other industries. Coffee, for instance. 30 years ago, behold, I was backpacking through the US, I remember, and you could get a cup of coffee for 25 cents over there. 25 cents for a cup of coffee. It tasted like water, but it was coffee. It was cheap, right? Now, 30 years later, you go to the US and you'll see lines in front of Starbucks every morning to buy a cup of coffee at $4, $5, $6. Lines will be 50% of the coffee market today is specialty coffee. 30 years ago, it's close to zero. Or probably where chocolate is today, around 1%. Just a small group of nerds like us. Craft beer. I also remember supermarkets in Denmark. Danish people like beer, like I guess English also. So back then when I was a kid, you know, it was about volume. Today you go to the discount supermarkets and you actually find a beer that costs $5 or $6. Craft beer is about 20% of the market today. Cheese, 15% of the market. Wine, bottles that retail for more than $15. 10% of the market. Chocolate, though, 1% only. Why is that? Well, one reason is that people don't know what is good chocolate, because they've been used to eating very sugary stuff, and when you give them really good stuff, they go, ooh. The first reaction from many people is the taste of too much. One of my first partners in this project is a guy called Robert Steinberg. Unfortunately, he died later on. But he was a medical doctor from Harvard, and he had a chocolate maker that was called Schaffenberger in Berkeley, USA. And he claimed that chocolate actually stimulates 800 taste sensors in your mouth, whereas wine only stimulates about 200. So in theory, tasting chocolate is much more complex than wine. Yet we are used to, if you use that metaphor, we're used to drinking, you know, third pressing of cardboard wine, of the cheapest, most horrible wine you can get. That's what we normally call chocolate. So far behind are we in this industry. Okay, so, and apart from that, it's also, the reason is that there aren't that many beans, good beans around today. Most of the beans that are grown today are for the reasons we started talking about, bulk beans. They're not very good beans, they're wild beans. So you can't really get good beans. And also marketing is extremely confusing, because when you go to the supermarket, almost all chocolate makers, even the ones with most horrible beans, most horrible product, will say the same as Hotel Chocolat. They'll say, my chocolate is excellent, it's premium. And it costs like a fifth of what really good chocolate costs, or a third. And so consumers are, of course, confused. They're also confused, why do we buy chocolate? Is it because we do poor people a favor, you know, a fair trade and all these things? Or is it because we want to save the environment? Or is it because we want something that tastes good? Imagine for a moment that you sold beer in order to save poor farmers, or to save the planet, that they should grow the input, what's it called, the rye, in an ecological way, so you get ecological beer. And you wouldn't buy your beer or wine because it tasted good, but because of the inputs. But that's how actually chocolate is today. We'll see, look at that. It appalls me. We'll get there. Okay, so cocoa grows on trees. It grows inside. It grows on the trees. Come pods. These are beautiful wine red pods. That's our variety that we will taste in a moment. And it's all year round. It's a perennial crop. Mostly in April, May, we have the peak of the harvest, but it's mostly all year round. Inside, when you open this pod, you will see the beans sit inside a pulp, a sweet pulp. There's typically 30 cocoa beans inside. Can send this around. So you can see, it looks like these are actually mine red beans. They're fermented and dry.
Don't eat the shells.
Yeah, everybody can take one. Don't just bite in it, because it's not been roasted. It's like a peanut, so it has like a shell around it. So you have to actually break it open if you're able to. Not all beans are easy to break open, but inside sits a little peanut. That one you can eat, but not. Don't get the shell in your mouth, because I'm sure it's completely.
And don't break a crown cracking. Just use your hands. No insurance taken out for that. So are these from Honduras?
Those are mine red beans from Honduras. Fresh from Honduras, actually. It's one of our latest crops.
So that's red Mayan, the pod.
Yes,
there.
Yes, that's mine.
So those are the dried but not roasted, that's what you're saying, beans from.
They come out in the pulp.
Right.
Then you have to take them out, and then you have to actually conduct a fermentation. You take them out with the pulp, and you put them in a big box together. And when you put sweet stuff together, it's just like wine, grapes. No? In the big box, they start to ferment. A lot of things happen, temperature goes up, enzymes start to work, and flavor comes out. If you dare bite this bean, you see it doesn't taste it very much. Sort of a little bit peanutty, but you can't really taste the chocolate, right? Yet these have been fermented and dried, so once you roast them, out will come the flavor. But if they were not fermented and dried well, you would get a very bitter flavor out of these. So you need to ferment and dry them really well.
But is the fermentation
What?
It's a wine.
No, actually, we collect all the pulp in containers. The truck drives around in the countryside in Honduras from one collection point to the next. The farmers would have cut the pots down the evening before. And in the morning, they get up really early, sort of 4 or 5 in the morning, and they start breaking open the pots. They put them in these buckets that we've given to them, and they're supposed to be clean and all that stuff. And we have technicians run around and check, and also that they don't mix up with other varieties that might be in this area, because we pay a premium price. And then our little collection truck comes around, it's a Kia truck that can carry sort of 2 tons in the back. Drives from one collection point to the next, and it collects all what we in Spanish call barra pulp. And then they drive back to a central fermentation place in San Pedro Sula, where we do the fermentation. And we mix it all together. And the bigger we make the fermentation batch, the better is the outcome. So we like to do a ton, 2 tons in one box.
Why is that? Sorry.
I actually don't know. Nobody really knows.
Nobody knows.
You ask a PhD in fermentation and drying. Actually, those guys exist from Friar University in Belgium. And they will be able to put a lot of chemical names on it. And they know which enzymes are at work, but they don't know why a bigger batch is better than a small.
Hmm.
So it's by trial and error.
Are you the first company that's grafted?
No, other companies have done it, but not in volume. They've done it in small volumes, but right. Not in big volumes. So you this, who could I mention who've done it?
So all the bulk beans out there are wild? They're
I would say 99%.
Yep.
Should be safe.
Have you named your variety?
Yes, it's called Mayan Red. We used to call it Indio Rojo because that's sort of the popular name.
Yeah.
But then somebody said it was racist, and then we changed it to Mayan Red. She came up with the same name, so that's fine. Mayan Red is fine. Yeah. Good. Cacao can only grow in the tropical belt, so the Romans could not have done to cocoa what they should have done, maybe. And what we're doing now to the beans. It's grown by smallholder farmers. Maybe 98% of all cocoa in the world is grown by very small farmers. No? They have typically 10 hectares. Do you use hectares in the
Yeah.
Good, so you know, 5 of those they would use for food crops like rice and beans for food security, they eat it themselves. And the other 5 they would use for a cash crop, typically coffee. It could be banana, it could be pineapple. Our farmers in Honduras, for instance, will have on average 1.6 hectares of cacao. So they don't completely depend on the cacao, they also have other crops, right? But still, it's very, very small. 1.6 is really small. In Guatemala, our farmers are a little bit bigger, but they have no chance of getting any economies of scale or do any farming that you would be used to seeing here in Europe. No? It's almost like you have apple trees in your backyard, so it's nothing like you see in commercial farms of apples. You can see tractors driving in and everything in one single row and very scientific with soil tests and all that. No, nothing. It's very rustic. Most of them don't use fertilizers. Nobody has any irrigation. So everybody depends on the rain coming down and all that stuff. All right, let's move on. You can notice that I don't have a flight to catch, so I'm just going on and on and on. So if you want me to shorten it up, just let me know. I've had half a glass of wine, so I've been talking about this for a long time. So most of the beans in the world today are bulk beans, 95%. The ICCO, the Cocoa Producers Organization, say 5% are fine. Of these fine, of course, most of them have been planted by seeds. So you would have, for instance, people on Madagascar, an island outside of Africa, you can find very good cocoa, but it's a mix, it's a blend. It's actually wild cacao because it has been planted by seeds, and only a few places have they tried to sort of order it a little bit up by grafting a little bit, but nothing in particular.
We will be tasting some later of Madagascar.
Yeah, and you would notice there are big differences. No, yep. There's some maybe a little bit of a touch of Madagascar, mm-hmm. Because it's an isolated island. Mm-hmm. They also have many animals actually you can find.
Oh, it's gorgeous, yes. I mean, I have a presentation showing some of the animals. It's so beautiful to go and live there.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. So they also have some good cocoa. In Ecuador, they also have some of their cocoa is mm-hmm. good, but it's all very wild, all of it. It's mixed up with all sorts of varieties, also non-good varieties. A lot of people will say, oh, you need to buy Ecuador chocolate. Doesn't mean anything because there's 180,000 tons coming out of there a year, and probably 90% of it is completely bulk, and the other 10% is still wild. But granted, they have okay flavor, a little bit grassy notes, but very varying because the variety has been planted by as wild varieties. So fine flavor, genetic variety is rare. Flavor notes, it's a little bit like wine. It's like when you taste it, you would taste something much more complex. If you taste a bulk chocolate thing, really bad one would be bitter and you don't want to eat it, right? If it's 70%, it's bad. But some of it can be just with a little chocolatey taste, what you're used to, sort of chocolate and sugar. But if you get fine chocolate beans, it would normally have fruity or nutty, spices, flowery notes. No? That's what you can recognize. It's complex, the flavor will change over time and will have a long aftertaste, typically. It's mostly from Latin America and Africa, apart from Madagascar. I would claim that it's very difficult to find any good cocoa there. So, of course, there's a market for bulk cocoa beans. If you eat a Mars bar, I actually do that, I must say, once in a while. If I have a sugar down or something, once a year, I eat a Mars bar. Snickers, I don't like Mars. Snickers, that's fine. M&Ms, yeah, somebody offers you an M&M, why not? No?
Well, actually,
no. But I recognize there's a market for it, no? But it's not really anything you would do. There's a market for it, just to say that. And then you have the good bars, so you have like Okeson from the UK, or I put here Benoit Niha from Belgium. What makes it the flavor good? Well, genetics we talked about, so conditions, rain, soil, other inputs may affect flavor. We actually don't really know. There's no scientific studies around it. We're trying ourselves to understand. We have Mayan bread in different microclimates in Honduras and Guatemala, and we're trying to understand how much the climate actually affects the flavor. But it's very difficult because on our end of the process, many factors influence the flavor. It can be, the collection time, how ripe the fruits were, when we dry the beans, whether it was raining or it was cloudy or very much a lot of sun, because we dry naturally in solar dryers. So all these things will influence. There's probably a list of 30 more little factors that could influence. We don't know. And fermentation and drying is very important. We talked about apples. This is a typical wild, any cocoa farm really, you would see this when you cut the pods down. So if the pods have different colors, it's because the genetics are different. Different shapes is because the genetics are different. So what you see here, typical, they are a lot of different genetics. It's like red apples with green apple with all sorts of apples. So what you get at the end, something that tastes like apple, but gone is the Granny Smith or gone is the Golden Delicious. That kind of varieties you can't get up because you mix it all together. It's the same thing in cacao. So you just get a chocolatey flavor. I'm a consumer, I go to the supermarket, this is what I see. What do I buy? I was just talking to a gentleman here early on about how I started all this, and I started to speak about that 20 years ago, before I got into this business, I got this crazy idea of trying to make the world's best chocolate cake. It lasted for about a couple of weeks or something. And I bought the Virona chocolate because I read about it in the newspaper, you know, and it was expensive, so I thought, yeah, maybe we'll try with that. I failed miserably, but as a consumer, I understand that this is really, really confusing because there's so much out there in the market. Lindt's 85% cocoa, Michel Cuisine also probably around that, 67%. So what is better? Well, 85% sounds like better, no? As a consumer, and it's cheaper. So, and I know Lindt's, no? I've seen it in commercials. It's a recognized brand. Whereas Michel Cuisine, who is that? Some Frenchman, no? And it's very expensive, and it's only 67%. So, as a consumer, I'd say Lindt's. Although, of course, the truth is that Lindt's is Ecuador's sort of probably really bad beans, no? That's been dutched, probably. They put some baking powder on it, so they took away the bad flavors of non-fermented beans. And they put it in, they said extra dark in Ecuador, probably. Whereas Michel Cuisine pays extra for reasonably good beans, mostly. Which one? Duffy's fantastic wine red bar, or this here from Hershey? It says cacao reserve, 65%. It cost only $3, and I know Hershey, so I'd go from Hershey if I was a normal consumer. Amano is really good. Or this here, Danish or Swedish brand, also 70%. Which one should I go for? I don't know. And this one, this is horrible. This is the worst thing ever. My ex-wife lives in San Francisco, a very expensive area of San Francisco. And once I was over there for dinner, they sent me down to buy wine. So I went to the local supermarket, and the upscale supermarket in the US is called Whole Foods. So I go down there, and and instead of going to the wine shelves, of course I go directly to the chocolate shelves. And I'm appalled because I see this, $2.99, for a bar, that the argument for buying it is not flavor, it is to save an animal. Please buy this chocolate bar to save an animal. Could you imagine that? In a bottle, on a bottle of wine, like a really nice sort of first Grand Cru or whatever, Syrah grape, what have we? And buy this wine so you can save an animal. Something went completely wrong in marketing there. You don't buy chocolate because you need it. You buy it because of the flavor. It's a luxury product. So why would you buy it to save an animal? I mean, I'm not against saving bonobo monkeys, but I think it's a bonobo. But it's just wrong. That's how we've started to think about chocolate, that we shouldn't buy it because of the flavor, but because we do something good. No? And look at this is what it says on the back. No? Love, you can honor the farmers. $2.99. We will look at how much they actually honored the farmers in a moment, how much they actually paid the farmers for this. Sustainable farming practices, what? We pay a social premium, let's look at that in a moment, for our ingredients to ensure that farmers are supported and species are protected. Please take a look at our certification by clicking on the back. Look at these guys, 72%, fantastic, I think that's good. Rainforest Alliance and some other stuff, it's non-GMO. Oh yeah, right, GMO doesn't really exist in cacao, so it's easy to be non-GMO. Fantastic bar, teaches. So let's look at these labels they put on. And people think, I read in confectionery news today that many consumers actually think that getting a fair trade label and an Utz label means that the quality is better of the chocolate. What? No, it has nothing to do with the quality. Utz has something to do with, they have a long list for a farmer to do, but it's something really about how do you organize the process at the farm, and then some consultant comes out and he checks, did you wash your hands before you took out the pulp and stuff like that. It has nothing to do with whether it's been the flavor of the beans. Absolutely nothing. Fair trade. That is a scam completely. Fair trade farmers are paid below poverty line. They're anchored in poverty. We look at that in a moment. The ecological part, the green part, that is also a total scam, because what's actually happening is that when you don't fertilize cacao, and for some reason it's allowed to fertilize apple trees and pears here in the developed world, fertilization is fine. And fertilization is actually not bad, it's just if you fertilize too much and it goes down into the groundwater, that's bad, right? So there's an issue here in Europe about that, but we don't tell the apple farmers you can't use fertilizer, right? But we tell the poor farmers, don't use fertilizers. I've seen it in Belize where we operate, so there's organic cacao from Belize. The organic farmers produce about 200 kilos a hectare a year, whereas a non-organic farmer can produce up to 2 tons a year per hectare, tenfold. They are paid about 10% more for their organic beans compared to if they had done non-organic. And most of those 10% don't go actually to the farmers, they go to the farmer cooperative that spend it on computers and cars and stuff. Yeah? So, and what happens with organic is that you could actually claim that it's non-organic because productivity per hectare is so low, then they need more area to plant cacao, so they cut down the rainforest in order to plant cacao. They need tenfold as much area to produce the same amount of cacao than if you had actually grown it non-organic. Yet you think that when you buy organic, you're doing something for nature, you're doing the opposite. It has no effect on flavor. Fertilization is just NPK, it's what the plant eats. It's not anything dangerous or bad. It's food for the plants. And just like humans, plants need to eat elsewhere they don't produce. So let's look at the price, the fair trade. No? First of all, according to the World Chocolate, whatever the Euro Monitor and the ICCO, the Cocoa Producers Organization, only 5% of what you pay for a bar actually goes to the farmer. Let's go back to $2.99. 5% of that retail price actually goes to the farmer. Let's do a little example. To go away from the monkey bar and look at this. You can't even see what market is because I don't want to really sort of trash any particular chocolate maker. So this is from Denmark, so everything is in the supermarket, the discount supermarket I normally go to. 12 kronos, that's about, 12.75, that's about the US dollars, 184 for a bar, you know, so it's even lower than the 2.99 for the monkey bar. It's 85% cacao, it's called Premier. Voila, it must be good. No? Has oats, look, fantastic. So 184 times 5%, that's 9 cents US for 100 grams. That's $92 for a kilo. So let's see, what does that translate into? Well, an African farmer, that's probably translates into child labor. Have you heard about that in Africa? Okay, so they're so lowly paid in Africa, the cocoa farmers, that in order to cut their costs, they use children to work in the cocoa fields, and sometimes they even sell children to work on other cocoa farms. So it's called child slave labor. And why do they do that? Is because they're evil? No, simply because they're paid so lowly that they're trying to get their cost down as much as possible. And it happens that child slave labor is like almost zero cost, I guess. And so let's see, the poverty line is a day, according to the World Bank, is 190 purchasing power parity a day per household member. No? Now, if I am a smallholder farmer in Africa, then I, according to statistics, I would produce on average of 390 kilo per hectare. A smallholder farmer has 2 hectares, so he'll produce 2 times 390. That will give him, and with the price of 0.92 cents per kilo, so that's $700-something, he would get a year, no? So 5 household members divided by 365 days, that gives you a per capita PPP of 39 cents. That is so way below the poverty line that it's ridiculous. And you can say, how can this happen even today? And you go to you guys, I go, well, I don't buy actually this cheap stuff, no? But never buy cheap chocolate, because what you're doing is actually not only buying a very bad flavor product, you're also perpetuating poverty and child slave labor. And the big companies, like, put some names on there, I hope there's nobody from Nestle, Barry Calvin?
I don't think so.
No, good. So, you know, what they do is that they say, oh, it's not about the pricing, it's about increasing the productivity of the smallholder farmers. So they make these, you know, they donate $10 million, $40 million, which is peanuts in an $80 billion industry, you know, to build a school or to do some, train some farmers about how they should be, the productivity should go up. For the last 30 years, productivity of African farmers have been the same. But yet, these big companies will have you believe that they're actually doing something against child slave labor, that they're helping the poor farmers and build schools and all that stuff. They're probably empty because there are no teachers. And so, that's a scam. So don't buy it, it doesn't taste good. So, at marginal cost, of course, a cocoa farmer won't have any incentive to ferment or dry a cocoa. And that's why most cocoa in the world is not dried or fermented, so it's really bad. And what they do, the big companies, that they put baking powder or soda or whatever on it, it's called the dutching process, and it takes out all the ugly flavors from non-fermented, fully dried cacao. So, you guys up there, you're pastry chefs or something, or starting to become. Where do you buy your baking chocolate from? Do you know the brands? What?
Calbo.
Damn. Belcalade, maybe? I'm even told that a big French chocolate maker, very renowned, 90% of the cocoa they buy is actually cocoa from Africa. Only 10% is from from fine sources, including guanaja. Including guanaja, 10 years ago, guanaja would actually have fine beans today. If you look on the, behind the box of this famous French chocolate maker, I won't mention the name because it might be a cousin in the future. It might be somebody here. So, you know, before 10 years ago, it would actually say where the beans came from. But not today. If you look behind the bar of these bars here, they just say it's a blend, right? Yeah, yeah, blend. So 10% are probably fine, the rest is cheap cocoa. Probably. So, okay, what are my advices to you when you go and look for a good chocolate bar? Well, first of all, you have experts here, and you probably don't have, most of you, an issue trying to find good chocolate bars, but you're looking for flavor and aroma, as we talked about, complex fruits, long aftertastes. Cocoa content, of course, means that you would be able to taste the bean, the raw material, the higher the cocoa content is. I myself am not a fanatic about it. I actually like Patrick Rocher, and I like many of these combined flavors. I think, like in any food category, you can combine different raw materials and get, if you balance them well, you can get a fantastic product. So I'm not a fanatic that you have to eat dark chocolate. But dark chocolate is good, and it is the base product, I guess. Look for the bean variety. You will not find it, because nobody really has a bean variety without, except us and maybe one more company. Was the cocoa fermented and dried properly? Yeah. They normally don't write about that. Country and origin doesn't really say anything. Ecuador mostly is bulk cocoa, so if you buy Ecuador, you don't really know what you're buying. What other origins are there out there? Madagascar? Well, Madagascar, the quality also really varies a lot. So that was it. Thank you very much. So please, after this, think about what you're buying. Demand good flavor, from wherever you buy from. Be critical, because if you buy good flavor, you're actually also doing something good, if we have to do good when you buy cocoa, because you would actually be incentivizing farmers to develop their product so it tastes better, so it's more differentiated, so farmers get more selling power against the chocolate buyer, the cocoa bean buyers. If you have a flat commodity product that you need to, put chemicals to so they taste flat, you won't get a good price. No, but if you try to get good flavor out of it and do like Romans did 2,000 years ago, you might get a better pain out of it. So take the power back from the big candy and the big cocoa buyers.
Frank, just a question. You didn't say at the beginning what got you into this in the first place. Why you set the business up 10 years ago?
Yeah, well, so we talked about that. And the problem is that it's a really long story, so it's difficult to make short. But it was really a coincidence. I had a high-tech company in the US. I sold, nothing to do. Wanted to quote unquote hug a tree. So when somebody said, "Oh, come down and work for this NGO for a couple of years," I did that. For poverty eradication, that was actually my idea. And then I found out that the whole NGO business is a scam, completely. It's only about donations and no real results in the field, and nobody gets anything done because the incentives are wrong. I believe in. Profit is good, actually. I think private companies are good to make this, but everybody in the supply chain have to make money, and it starts with the farmers. So what we said is that, okay, we want fine flavor cocoa, but we also want to guarantee that the farmers are paid so they get out of poverty. So we guarantee our farmers a relatively high price for farm gate, which is a little bit of an issue, because then we have to have buyers also buy from us at a very high price, which sometimes can be a negotiation point, because we also have to make money. It's expensive to do cocoa, to farm cocoa with smallholder farmers. There's no economies of scale, so it's actually quite an expensive product. So,
yes, I was going to say, do you want to guide us through a taste of your expressions of your Honduras beans? We have four different ones, plus the flavored one, of course. Can you suggest which to start with? Do you want to start with the two dark ones?
Let's start with Emma's.
No? I'll switch the light on.
Yep. So Emma can talk a little bit about this, if you want.
Okay.
This is hotel chocolate.
So Emma, do you want to say a few words about that? Thank you.
So just using Frank's bean, so there's Honduras made red.
I'm saying, this is Emma from Hotel Chocolat, yeah. So I don't know if everybody heard that. Right, thanks, Emma.
She makes the chocolate, actually.
She makes the chocolate.
And so, this is a 72% dark, made using a light roast. So, start off initially at 130 degrees and then continue at 110 degrees. So, it's got quite a light roast profile just to bring out the flavours. And then we finish it off in a ball mill to get the final flavour. So when we started developing, we were looking for about a 70% couverture, and then once we adjusted the final recipe, we ended up as a 72% dark.
Which is quite a high percentage, no? You can really taste the beans. 100%
so is disgusting. It is high, but it's in our range, it is actually the lowest percentage.
Oh, really?
So, yes.
No, but I actually think when you taste Hotel Chocolat, to Hotel Chocolat's credit, is one of the few chocolate makers that done a really good job at explaining to the consumer what good chocolate is, with all the chocolate clubs, and it's been I think hopefully over the years that would have sort of a spillover effect, no, in the industry.
Yeah.
It's really difficult, so, but we started actually by doing phenotyping, which is visually identifying trees. When we started the whole project, we got a the world's number two geneticist, number one, whatever you want, in cocoa, Philippe Lachenot, a Frenchman, down, and he's a complete nerd, by the way. When he came out of the airplane and into the taxi and back to the hotel, and he had his nose against the window because he was looking for cocoa trees on the way. So it's very nerdy. But he was down a month, I think, and we hired some engineering students from the local agronomy agronomy university, and we roamed the countryside of Honduras, simply tree by tree. And we physically looked for trees that could be of a non-forastero variety. Forasteros are the robusta of cocoa. That's not to say that forasteros cannot have a good flavor, but that was only a practical way of approaching this project.
There's always a song with Arabica, or that's how you pronounce it, one of the strong men. And I just wonder whether we all get some more.
Probably, but some if you really read the between the lines, no, you'd say a lot of these marketing guys will not be specific, and when they're not specific, you can be sure it's because they bought something cheap. No? But anyway, physically, can you look at a cocoa tree? Yes, you can. So we actually identified that 2% of the trees in Honduras were of a Trinitario variety, which is not one variety, it's like thousands of varieties, no? But of these thousands, we then selected one that was more homogeneous. There were only 400 trees left of Mayan red. We found it in a small grove in the north of Honduras, in the jungle, a beautiful place with a river and big rocks and stuff. And there was an old woman, Doña Felipa, who had it, and the trees were dying, they were very old, right? And she was too old to actually harvest. But Philippe, when he found that, was really happy, I remember. And we did a micro fermentation of Mayan red, and we sent the samples to different experts around the world, including Valrhona, by the way, and the Mori. And I remember these guys actually came down to Honduras, and Gianluca Franzoni from Domori, was the founder of Domori, a famous Italian chocolate maker, said that this was the best chocolate that Valrhona had ever made. And then we knew that we had something good, so we selected Mayan red. Also because we had 400 relatively similar Mayan reds, no, from the same farm. Whereas the other Trinitarios, you would have 10 trees in one farm, and then another 20 kilometers away, you would have another 10 trees, but not of the same genetic variety. So you couldn't really start a grafting program, because for each tree, you could produce maybe 1,000 trees in a year. No? So. That's not true. 300, 400.
what should we move on to now? Oh, yeah. We've had the 72, we can either have the hotel chocolate
dark milk or the Friesholm. So we have two dark milks and we have the Friesholm, which presumably is...
Let's try the Friesholm actually, because it's really interesting because the roasting profile is very different from hotel chocolat. Friesholm is a Danish chocolate maker, very small. His factory is about an hour's drive away from where I live in Copenhagen. And so I've been down to his factory, and he likes to not roast very much. So what you get here is very bold, lots of polyphenols. Of course, the way to taste it is first you would smell it, no? And then you bite it and divide it in your mouth to get all those 800 senses working. And don't think of anything except just experiencing the flavors and how they change over time.
It is for a bar, yeah.
At least.
One of the most expensive. It's probably the most expensive in the UK. Mm. Yeah.
But now you know why.
Yeah, indeed, indeed.
It's very nice.
So, yes, Friesholm, name to look out for. Okay, and then we have two dark milks. You want to talk about the rule of, or do you, Sarah, want to talk about the rule of milk in chocolate? Why? Either of you want to comment? Well, we have to taste your dark milk. So why, you know, what do we anticipate, and why would anyone add milk to these beans?
You just asked a very good question. Why would anybody add milk to these beans?
Well, I love dark milk, so there we go. There is a good reason, I think. Frank, you quite like dark milk chocolate, don't you? In its place, dark milk. You don't.
I'm with Frank on that one.
I do.
However, I think that it's a custom which has been introduced. I think it was circa 1880 approximately when Nestle came up with the idea of dried milk powder to add to chocolate, because of course before that they were trying to add liquid milk, because remember chocolate was always a drink, so the idea of adding milk goes back quite a long way to make the drink, but they couldn't add milk to the chocolate because it just seized. So as I said, it was Nestle who came up with the idea of milk, and then Cadbury's perpetuated the myth in approximately 1904 with Cadbury's dairy milk. And of course the milk is sweet, and people have picked up that sweetness, and it's become, I don't know how much milk chocolate there is in the world, but it's a huge, I mean, when I got interested in chocolate 30 years ago, milk chocolate was probably about 97% of all chocolate, 1% white, and the rest was a horrible dark.
Well, of course you're saying milk, but I mean a lot of that was bulk confectionery, not... I mean, what I have brought, what I hope people will like, is good
milk. Well, it's good to differentiate.
It's good to differentiate, that's right. So, and we have two examples of Frank's beans being used in a dark milk chocolate. Anyhow, we'll see how people react. So
what I always say when I start, which is something Frank has already covered, but when we're tasting chocolate, of course, it's not so much now, but when I started this, I had to... clarify the difference between chocolate, which we're going to be tasting, as we have just tasted, and chocolate confectionery. And you know, I firmly believe that we've all grown up on chocolate confectionery. In other words, chocolate that's got so much sugar that none of us have really tasted the chocolate. And the other problem with sugar, of course, as we all know, it is addictive. So when people say they're addicted to chocolate, I've got a pretty good idea what that means. And how did I get into all this? About 30 years ago, when I was researching food for a series of films which I never actually made, I met Michel Roux Senior, and he gave a demonstration of three courses. I'm sorry, I can't remember what the first two were, but the last one was a chocolate truffe gâteau, and I thought, don't want to eat this, don't like chocolate. as it got nearer and we tasted it, I thought, my God, I've just died and gone to heaven. So I said to him, what is this? And he said, well, this is chocolate. And I said, I realise that, but it's not like chocolate I've ever tasted before. So he said, well, you obviously never tasted chocolate before. And that was a real challenge, and that's what started me off. And a few months later, I rang him and said, could you teach me more about this chocolate? So he introduced me to his pastry chef, and for several months, I used to visit his pastry chef on a Saturday afternoon after he'd finished, and it just happened to be in Wandsworth. It was half a mile from where I live. So a wonderful chef called Ian Ironside taught me all he knew about chocolate and how to make chocolate truffles, which I actually did for about 25 years. So I kind of know chocolate from one end to another. Sorry, I'm talking really quick because we've only got 5 minutes. It was Glyn Christian who actually wrote about my chocolate truffles in about 1993. And I was approached by Penguin and asked if I'd like to write a book, which I thought was a wonderful idea, but I'd never thought about it. And of course that actually started this whole period of research. And in those days, really, the only decent chocolate you could get in this country was from Cocoa Barry, which is now part of Barry Callebaut. And so they taught me quite a lot about the actual production. I went out to Paris, I saw how cocoa beans became chocolate. I asked them at the time, I'd really like to go and see cocoa growing, and they said, what do you want to do that for? And I said, well, I'm actually writing a book. And one thing led to several others, and I went out to Mexico and I learned all about the history of chocolate and how chocolate was started with the Olmecs, 1500 BC, and remains of the cocoa found in the graves, and that is because they think that the Olmecs were taking the cocoa with them as a gift to the gods, or maybe to sustain them on their journey to the afterlife. Then the Mayans, of course, 600 BC to 600 AD, found lots of uses of chocolate, medicinal, gastronomic, religious, all those things. It was incredible, all in the book, which I have to say won a Guild of Food Writers Jeremy Round Award in 1999. Then in 900 AD, there were the Toltecs. The Toltecs have this wonderful legend which goes, which says that the Quetzalcoatl came to Earth on the beam of the morning star. Quetzalcoatl became the god of chocolate. But Quetzalcoatl was the winged serpent. Well, he bought cocoa and he planted it and showed the people how to use it and make it into this wonderful, nourishing drink. And this really hacked off the gods from where he'd come. So they came back down to Earth after him, chased him away. They made him drunk on the local cactus drink, which is pulque. And of course, poor old Quetzalcoatl fled. But as he fled, he vowed to come back as a fair-skinned, bearded man. And of course, 600 years later, that was precisely what Hernan Cortes and his band of Spanish were. And
so I switch this light off. Is that all right? Okay for everybody. I'll switch it on again if you can't see what you're tasting.
So there we have Hernan Cortes. And of course the amazing thing about it was that the Spanish, when they arrived in Mexico, were pretty close to where the Olmecs originated. And they came, of course, with their, not only was he fair-skinned bearded man, but they came with their armour, their horses, their wheels, their cannons, and of course poor old indigenous people of what was then eventually called the New World have never seen anything like that before. So it wasn't surprising that Cortes and his men got a pretty free passage to Tenochtitlan, which is where Montezuma resided. Of course, one of the other problems was that Montezuma had really alienated the majority of people in and around Mexico City, which is what it's now called, because he exacted so many taxes from all these people. So Cortes and his band of men managed to pick up thousands and thousands of disenfranchised Mexicans on their way. And so by the time they got to Tenochtitlan, of course, they had a huge army of people. And of course, I'm sure that you all know that the Aztecs were very disillusioned by Montezuma and stoned him to death. Well, that's what we think happened, but we're not really sure. But of course, the other thing about the Spanish, when they got to Mexico, and indeed Mexico City, or Tenochtitlan is it called, they found not only cocoa as a drink, which is called huacoatl, which they said was disgusting and not fit for pig swill, but they had to get used to it because there was no wine and they were sick on the water. So the books tell us. The other thing, of course, they found that the cocoa beans were used as money, so it's incredibly valuable. 100 beans would buy a slave, 10 beans roughly would buy a rabbit. So the Spanish have now discovered all sorts of wonderful indigenous things in... Oh, I forgot to show the picture of Montezuma. There is the wonderful Montezuma. I think he was much maligned, and he's one of my heroes in the chocolate history. Of course, the Spanish then took cocoa beans and all sorts of other things back to Europe, and it became very much the preserve of the aristocratic, the rich, and the and the kings and queens of the time. But most of the uses of cocoa were discovered by the religious orders that went out to the New World to convert all those Aztecs that hadn't been killed in war and fighting, and the diseases the Spanish took out with them. Of course, they went to convert those that were left to Catholicism, and it was the monks and the nuns that really discovered all the, well, the languages, the uses of all the wonderful things that the Spanish had brought back, and particularly cocoa. And as these religious orders came back to Europe, they brought with them the knowledge of the wonderful chocolate drink. And you have to remember that just like the Mayans, they discovered all the wonderful medicinal properties of the chocolate drink. That absolutely fascinated the Europeans, and it became incredibly popular for 100, 150, 200 years. And of course it became the preserve also, or very useful, in the apothecary's medicine chest. And the drinks such as tea, coffee, and particularly cocoa, were incredibly important, again, because they were thought to cure just about everything, from headaches to stomach aches to psychological things to skin diseases, you name it. And Xoco apple, now called, by this time it's called chocolate, of course, was the just elixir for just about everything. And so it was when the Industrial Revolution started that the Quakers, who were the apothecaries, knew all the uses of chocolate. And so again, not surprisingly, Cadbury, Fry, Roundtree, etc., were the ones who perpetuated the whole idea of chocolate, believing, quite rightly, ahead of their time, that chocolate was incredibly good for us. The Industrial Revolution brought, all this time, by the way, chocolate was a very bitter, grainy drink, and the Industrial Revolution brought the possibilities of making this very bitter, grainy drink into something much smoother. And it was Van Houten, a Dutchman, at the beginning of the 19th century, circa 1820, I think it was, who developed this chocolate press, which was a hydraulic press that was originally, the idea was to press down on the cocoa to virtually make it into, to get rid of all the little grainy bits in it. But what he actually did was he pressed the cocoa butter out of the cocoa bean. Because if you look at your plates, you've actually got, there are cocoa beans on your plates. I'm sure most of you have seen cocoa beans by now. These cocoa beans have been roasted, so you can winnow them, just crush them, and the cocoa nibs or the seeds will come out and you can eat them. Now, these, amazingly, not only do they contain Frank says 800, between 400 and 800 wonderful different tastes and flavours and aromas, which is incredible, but 55% of this is cocoa butter, approximately. Depends on the beans, doesn't it? Some contain a bit more or the others, but for the sake of the argument, it's about 55%. When this is crushed, the cocoa butter is released, and when it's warm, it looks like olive oil. And what is left, of course, the brown bits, are then crushed and made into cocoa powder. So what we have at the beginning of the 19th century is we have our crushed brown bits, which are made into cocoa, and voila, at last we have this wonderful, smooth chocolate drink. The big problem for the manufacturers was the cocoa butter, because they didn't really know what to do with it. So typically Fry, Cadbury, flushed down the drain. Fry was always being fined. I expect Cadbury was as well, but it was Fry particularly. Didn't know what to do with the cocoa butter, flushed it down the drains. Now, the amazing thing about cocoa butter, this is one of the unique things about chocolate, is that it melts just below body temperature, but remains stable at room temperature. I'm sure you've all seen cocoa butter, but when, of course, it sets in the drains, it is rock hard. So you can imagine what that did to the drains of Bristol and indeed Birmingham. Mm. So it took quite a long time for a grandson of Fry, one day fiddling about with his chocolate, wondering what to do with this wonderful cocoa butter, to mix some of the cocoa butter back into the cocoa. And voila, first time, there was the bar of chocolate. Well, that's not how chocolate's made now, but that was the beginning of a bar of chocolate. That was the first time chocolate was really eaten as for pleasure. Lots of other things happened in the 19th century. One of them was that up until 1820 approximately, all cocoa came from Central and South America. Apart from some of the cocoa that had been planted in Indonesia by the Dutch, but mostly it came from Central and South America. There was a Portuguese count on his way back from Brazil to Portugal, and he stopped at other Portuguese dominated territory, which was Sao Tome and Príncipe, and that's where he planted the cocoa that he was going to plant in Portugal. And cocoa, of course, took like ducks to water, and that's where much of the, by about 1880, much of the cocoa that was being used by Europeans actually came from Africa. You have to remember at the time it was still a long way from Central and South America, so it made chocolate very expensive. So this was a way of making chocolate a bit cheaper. One of the problems, of course, at the time was that the Sao Tome and Príncipe cocoa was cultivated and grown and looked after by the slaves of the Portuguese. And it took a whole 20 odd years after Cadbury, the son of Cadbury, went out to the territory, discovered what was happening. And of course it wouldn't happen now, but it took 20 years before he got the message to all the cocoa and chocolate manufacturers using the beans from Portuguese dominated territory to tell them about this terrible, because you have to remember that we're talking about the Quakers. These are the people, the religious people, and it was just completely against their religion to have cocoa that was grown by the slaves. So that was when the British planted cocoa in the Gold Coast, now Ghana of course, the French planted cocoa in the Ivory Coast, the Germans in other parts of Africa, the Dutch and so on. So that was the beginning of cocoa in Africa. So you see, cocoa in Africa, it's very, very new to the history of cocoa and chocolate. Right. Sorry, I could tell you a lot more, but Sylvia's giving me the eager eye.
I am. Only because the place shuts down and all the electricity goes off and we get locked in eventually.
I won't go into this. This was the first cocoa tree I ever saw, circa 1996 in Mexico. And it's very, very, well, when it's in focus, it's very emotive. But the first thing I realised that cocoa, chocolate, is not necessarily brown. When I look at chocolate now, I never see brown. I always see these wonderful different, when you look at them, they're all different colours and pinks and purples and Frank's already talked about the fermentation, so I won't bore you with that. Or the drying. Now, the way that the Mayans and many people in Central and South America used to make the chocolate, and they still do now, is the seeds of the bean that you've got on your plates would have been put on this metate, that's the concave stone that's made from volcanic rock or something like that, and the metal pili, which is like the rolling pin. Crush the seeds with the end of the rolling pin, which starts to release the cocoa butter. And you have to remember, we're looking at temperatures of about 40 degrees, and of course the warmth also helps to release the cocoa butter. So you can see what happens. It becomes a sort of a soft paste. So here's our Mayan woman doing exactly that. She's got this soft paste, she's making it into a ball, and she hands on to her sister, her daughter rather, which she makes the ball and rolls it into this sausage shape, and then with the palm of the hand goes ch-ch like that and comes up with these pretty um, incredibly old. You can. This is what the chocolate actually is like when it's been set. So she, as I said, she chops up the sausage shape and put it in a bucket of cold water. Not in the cold water, put the bucket in the cold water, and the next morning these are set solidly. Actually, it smells pretty disgusting. I used to smell cocoa. These are about 20 something years old. And so then the next morning we went into the market and bought these. Now, very quickly, how is chocolate made? Roasting. Frank talked about roasting. Very important. Frank's already explained that. Every chocolate manufacturer has a different way of roasting, whether it's a fast roast, whether it's a slow roast, whether it's a low temperature or a high temperature. Most commercial chocolate manufacturers will roast at a high temperature for a short space of time because the whole idea about commercial chocolate is to save money, to make as much money as possible, and to cut corners. So then we do the winnowing process. You've winnowed the beans, so you know what that is. That is to release the outside of the bean, the shell. Most of the shell goes into garden compost or whatever it is. And what do you do with your shells?
We turn ours into drinking tea or to make the cocoa gin, so to take the flavour out of it and use it in other things.
You've been tasting some, well, not the cocoa gin, but some vodka with cocoa beans. That's whole beans. Do you use whole beans actually to flavour the whole thing? Or do you use it now?
So our beans are now ground. Of course, nobody uses these anymore. Well, if they do, they only for show. But I'm just showing you this because all the majority of chocolate factories I've been to, not Amadei or Hotel Chocolat, because you can actually see what's happening. But most of the big chocolate manufacturers, the cocoa beans go in one end and come out the other, and you don't actually see anything. So, but that is the old-fashioned 100 and something years old, as you can see, the grinding mill. And that reduces our cocoa nibs to a paste. Then the refining process is really important. So our paste is then mixed with sugar and it becomes something called a dough. It's now refined. In my opinion, refining makes the best chocolate. It reduces all the particles of the sugar and the chocolate down to below, depends on the chocolate manufacturer, say 20 microns, which is less, which is about the size of our taste buds, which is going to render it to something beautifully velvety and smooth. This is a chocolate refiner. Now what amazed me was when the first time I saw a refiner, which was actually at Cocoa Barry, when you could actually see what they were doing. And when it came off the last, they had this fine stainless steel, five stainless steel rollers. Some do three, but five is, I think, the optimum. These stainless steel rollers whiz backwards and forwards. I think it's about 15,000 rolls a minute. And what is amazing is the cocoa mass with the sugar ends up like fine face powder. So when you put your finger on it, you can hardly feel it. And that's it's been refined to below the level that you're going to kind of not feel on the tongue. This then goes into a conching machine. Conching machine simply because when Rudolf Lindt discovered it, it was an apprentice, it's always an apprentice sport, apparently left the grinding machine on all night, and when Rudolf Lindt came in the morning, he discovered that this grinding process had created something really smooth and silky. So he perfected it, and it was originally big tanks with the shells, the paddles shaped like shells, and of course you all know that conch is Spanish for shell, which is why it's called the conching machine. It's as simple as that. This is a modern one where it's like there's a piston that goes backwards and forwards and beats our wonderful cocoa mass, whatever you want to call it at this stage. It's emulsifying it and it's driving off any unwanted volatile flavours. Now, Amadei, we're going to taste in a moment, actually conches for 72 hours. There are a lot of chocolate manufacturers that say that actually destroys the flavour, but for me it doesn't. What happens with Amadei is that it takes a while, like a really fine wine, it develops in the mouth. It doesn't destroy the flavours at all, in my humble opinion. And then you can make the chocolate into wonderful truffles like that, which I don't anymore.
Oh,
I know. I think we're going to miss out on the milk chocolate.
I have plenty to compensate later. Yes,
well, yeah, the milk chocolate is just an experiment. So try it at home.
Yeah.
Try it, milk chocolate, a couple of more sea salt flakes with the other one. And what you're doing, of course, you're seasoning it. And a lot of chocolate manufacturers are adding salt to their chocolate now, which I think is fantastic. Not too much. I'm just wondering where we want to go with this. What we don't eat, you can just take home with you.
I think that's a good idea, yes. Just taste a couple of most really striking kind of examples.
Well, they're all striking examples.
I know. The most is what I said, the most striking. We've about 3 minutes, which is sad, but yeah.
Well, we're going to take 7 minutes. I just wanted to add something to what Frank had said about Ecuador. When I was in Ecuador, Frank's absolutely right about the price of the cocoa beans, but Ecuador is one of the few countries where they actually make chocolate, because many of the chocolate factories are actually in Quito, which is about 8,000 feet above sea level. So it's a bit like it's a bit like London. It's quite cold. And I visited about 3 chocolate manufacturers, and they were all complaining about the quality of the cocoa beans that they get from their own country. And I dared to suggest to one of the chocolate manufacturers, I said, "You're always complaining about the price of the quality of your cocoa. Why don't you pay the cocoa farmers more money, and you'll get obviously a better loyalty and a better quality of cocoa?" Absolute kel our own. Why would we do that? All they do is they drink it, or they'd go and squander it. It wouldn't make any difference to the cocoa at all. So I think that's a barrier that somehow or another we just have to move on. And I don't know how you'd actually change that. How would you change that?
Education. Maybe that money should go into education.
That's what many of the big manufacturers are saying is absolutely happening. That's what Barry Callebaut is saying. We've just had a wonderful conference on sustainability in cocoa. And that's what everybody will say. And I think that to an extent that is actually what's happened. Anyway, let's taste this. This is chocolate made from beans grown in Peru.
Which one is it?
Sorry. It's got Blanco de Criollo on it. Slightly coloured with a black stripe. Now what I noticed about the freeze-on chocolate was it released its creaminess straight away. This does take a while. I think Frank described tasting incredibly well. What is important about good chocolate is harmony and balance in the mouth, and the first thing you should taste is fruit, because that's what cocoa is. And whatever else you taste fruit. From there you get all sorts of layers. Chantal Cody always describes it very well. There are base notes, middle notes, and upper notes. And lots of other notes going on. What you get out of chocolate depends what mood you're in, it depends what you've tasted before, it depends what you're about to taste, who you're with, what time of day it is. I taste the same chocolate most days, and I never cease to amaze what an amazing difference that I can taste. I think Hotel Chocolat is a fantastic example of how we in Britain have got over that terrible slur of being the kind of bad people of chocolate. I mean, it was a joke 20 years ago, and all we were known for is Cadbury's and nasty commercial chocolate. So well done, Angus, I say. Right, let's just taste this one, which is Porcelana. Porcelana is made from... Porcelana is one of the... a very rare cocoa variety, which is mainly grown... Well, it's pretty much only grown in Venezuela. I won't tell you a story about how I was told that Porcelana grows in Mexico, because the chocolate was absolutely disgusting. Very delicate, you wouldn't think it was 70% cocoa solids.
What is the variety?
porcelain or something.
What's the variety?
It's actually called porcelain.
It's a hybrid of the Criollo. There are three main varieties of cocoa: Criollo, Forastero, and Trinitario. Of which there are
24,000.
24,000 hybrids. A lot of hybrids.
To date, that's what the US.
When I wrote my book, which was a long time ago, a number of experts reckon there are about 240 to 250 hybrids. So we've moved on a lot in the last 16 years. So this is quite different from any other chocolates we've been tasting. Nobody says you have to like it, but all the chocolates that we're tasting tonight are good chocolates. And it's very much a personal taste of whether you actually do like it or not. Okay, I'm just going to taste one more. We're not giving all the endless chocolate a fair chance, but this is Michel Clouzel that Frank mentioned. It actually won two chocolates we've just tasted in their time. It won the Golden Bean from the Academy of Chocolate Awards. This Michel Clouzel, the Village Rescinda, actually won a gold. Was it a couple of years ago?
A couple of years ago. Yeah.
Now, when I smell it, you know, it sounds bad, but there's a slightly sort of coaly, sort of coke effect to it. It's jungly and it's. And at the moment tonight, I can get leather notes from it. Anybody else want to tell me what you're getting out of this?
Smoke.
Smoke. It is smoky. Actually, it isn't smoked, it's smoky.
Smoky, yeah.
Smoked is normally from off beans. Have you got a tray? Are you?
No, I'm so sorry.
I don't want to interrupt anybody.
Why?
Oh dear, dear, dear. I have got some little bags if people need them to take samples for themselves. That later.
Creamy? That is fine?
Yeah.
A sign of not very good chocolate is when it hasn't been fermented properly and the process ferment that the tannins that are in the beans have not been properly developed. So it's like eating a chocolate like that is like a cheap wine. When you feel like you've had a head drop walk backwards through your mouth and your cheeks are puckering and your eyes are watering. I hope you can get anything like that from any chocolates.
No, but of course that's one of the functions of milk or cream would be to soften the tannins. I mean, I know that's of course why there is so much bad milk confectionery.
I'm going to end on this one and just to say that we can't go through it all tonight, but when you think all these tastes and flavours are actually the responsibility of all the naturally occurring chemicals in our chocolate. Ones that, of course, everybody has heard about, theobromine, caffeine, phenethylalanine, and so on, and then many, 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 many others.
Which one is that you've got?
Oh, sorry, it's the black one, Amadei 70%. Now, if you think about those naturally occurring chemicals that we are perfectly aware of, when you think that if you allow a dog, a 20 kilogram dog, to eat 100 grams of 70% chocolate, it's likely to kill it because the theobromine in it is so strong for a dog that it affects the liver, which shuts down, and of course that means the rest of the all the other organs go with it. I'm only telling you that because. Just think about that. If the theobromine in 100 grams of chocolate can kill a 20 kilogram dog, that gives you an idea of the power of the chemicals in the chocolate. We can go on talking about this later, but I think we better move on. Are we going to have this chocolate one?
Sorry.
Are we going to have a chocolate one?
There isn't time, amongst right. other things. It's not in full flow. We'll have to do it another time, unless you just peer through the window. Because we've literally only got about 20-25 okay. minutes at most. Really, we should finish at 8:30. And we've got a lot more chocolate and a lot of wine to taste.
Okay. Well, I'm going to finish now by saying less is more. Oh yes, I am also enraged at the moment, because I've read an article in the Tatler, which talks about what to be snobby about and what not to be snobby about. Toilets notwithstanding, they're actually saying it's not right, it's no, you know how long you have to be snobby about cheap chocolate.
What?
So I should be tweeting later.
Teach you to read
that.
That's obviously.
Well, you're absolutely right.
Okay, we're going to go to the opposite extreme almost now and have some white chocolate in a moment or yellow chocolate. Sarah, what I'll do is, as I swap this round before showing a few slides from Madagascar, is ask Sarah Jane to say a little bit about matching wine chocolate, or if you like, if you prefer, what are the parallels in tasting? What are the parallels in concepts of terroir?
I think I would say it, because I think the chocolate is the really important.
All right.
I brought some wine, and I'm very aware at the time, so what I'll do is I will put it out so that you can come up and serve yourself.
You want to introduce the wine?
I want to just quickly introduce them, no more than that, because I think we need to focus on these chocolates. What I have brought is mainly fortified wine, because the key word we've just had is tannin. And what you find is that people say to you, oh, I've got this lovely red wine, nice red table wine, and you know it's got lots of tannin and quite a lot of acidity. And the one thing you're going to find often in chocolate is tannin and acid, and you don't just don't want to give it another one. So what I have provided here is things that you can come up and try. One is obviously Madeira, which has very marked acidity, but it has terrific amount of sugar going with it. So, and it has raisin and orange dried fruit characters, which can be interesting. I often find that the worst thing you can do is what we're doing here, which is matching wine or spirits with a bar. Actually, you need to have a bar with nuts, or you need to have something else as well. Just expecting, you know, I think at that point you're suppressing the bar. What you want to do is to get the bar to speak and then have something very nice beside it. So I've got some that, and I've got some really terrific 20-year-old tawny port. And just to say to you, tawny port is always a good thing to have. Whatever you're doing, you must have this anyway, but get 20 years, don't have 10. This is very important. People will try and get you to have 10, it hasn't got enough character, but this is has a lovely maturity, and again a kind of caramelised character, which is very attractive. And then I've got a quirky thing, extremely quirky thing, which is a thing like a Vin du Naturel from the Rhone Valley. It's made out of Grenache. It's extremely purple colour. It tastes like blackcurrant juice on steroids. Mm-hmm. And I think again, with when you've got a dark chocolate with fruit, it's a quite interesting match. And then on top of that we have vodka and gin.
We have a couple of spirits, right. So this is from Cotswolds Distillery. They call it an espresso martini, essentially. I mean, they're very, very good, very fine, proper gin distillers. They are actually distilling coffee beans with the gin. It's very subtly sweet, it's very, very mildly junipery, and we thought it might go well with Emma's wonderful gin bar made with Frank's beans, I'll put it by the relevant chocolate. Okay.
And then finally, well, you can maybe you should introduce the salted caramel cocoa vodka.
Yeah. So it's taking the salted vodka, the caramel vodka, adding salt to it, and then leaving the whole beans to impart their flavour onto the vodka.
So I would definitely say the message to take from this is you don't need Christmas pudding this year. What you actually need is a few of these bottles and a selection of really fine chocolate, and that's all you need. But maybe a cup of coffee afterwards.
All right. Bear with me for a couple of minutes. I'm going to pass around these beads. This is very unique. This is a first. Tell me if anyone else has done it. As far as they're aware, it's first. This is Chocolat Madagascar, and they are one of the very few companies that actually manufacture chocolate on site, giving a lot of value, money, whatever you like, back to the farm, back to the people living, growing, and producing. Thank you. And this is the first, these are roasted, fully roasted cacao, or now cocoa beans, because they're roasted, covered in chocolate from Samberano Valley in Madagascar. If you bear with me for a couple of minutes, I'll go through these slides. I'll keep the lights on, which does make the animals look rather less beautiful, but there we go. You can see what a beautiful area it is. It looks almost like the Swiss Alps there, doesn't it? And it's actually huge, 2.5 times larger than the UK. I always thought it was a small island, and how did so much good chocolate come from there? But no, it's 2.5 times larger than the UK. You can see where it's positioned. I mean, Sarah told you how chocolate came to come over to Africa, but it's been rather isolated. Unfortunately, I haven't got time to go through all of this, but it does mean that they have some very, very particular cacao varieties there. I mean, they are blends, they are hybrids, but they are very particular. Just as they have some very wonderful animals. I mean, look at this, it's a giraffe weevil. There we go, not much to do with chocolate, but a lot to do with the indigenous uniqueness of Madagascar. So there we go, produces 0.1% of the world's cacao, not very much. It has been designated officially as fine flavour cacao, introduced in the 19th century there. This is some of the area from which these beans are grown, and of course lots of lush rainforest there. Beautiful colours of cacao beans and so on, and there are criollos, forasteros and trinitarios, theoretically. I mean, Neil has made some wine links there. Of course, as we know, there are many hybrids. This is the inside of a cocoa pod, and it basically tells you that one tree will make about, you know, 8 bars of chocolate, roughly speaking. So you can imagine how little the most farmers are paid, and how intensive and skillful the production is. Admission there that actually, okay, you've got all these different colours of seeds and so on, but nobody can really fully analyse genetics, even within a single pod. This is more about the production process, which you've seen, the gradual fermentation of the beans. I can't go through all the chemistry of it all. You've heard a lot about it already. It's more a matter of tasting yourself. Again, here we have lots of fruity notes to the fore, citrus nuances. Very different flavours. Despite those high acidity red fruit flavours coming out of Madagascar. So Orcasson and Chocolat Madagascar produce very different chocolate to my mind. There we go, so it's called Chocolaterie Robert in Madagascar. They don't call it that outside of Madagascar because they want to reinforce the point that this is actually made in the country where the cocoa is grown. So here, and I won't pass this around necessarily because you can try it with a drink, so it'd be the best way of doing it. We have some dark milk again, and we have this, and I will explain about this very quickly. This is yellow, what they call yellow chocolate, and you saw the cocoa butter that Sarah hammered onto the steel surface. This is a bit softer than that, you'll be pleased to know. But essentially, it is cocoa butter. There's no dark cacao solids in there. But this is non-deodorized cocoa butter. We haven't gone through that process of deodorizing, but most milk chocolate is, I mean, it's just fat and sugar, basically, with vanilla covering up. There is no vanilla in here. You may or may not like it. You don't have to like it at all. But this is what cocoa butter from the beans in the Samberano Valley tastes like. There is no vanilla added, just sugar and some milk. So there we go. But try it with, I don't know, it might go nicely with Madeira. I'll leave it here next to this one. I'll leave in the background in a moment some slides showing from a man called Josef Zotter, who is a real hero of mine. And contrary to a lot of what Frank was saying, that he loves and admires Josef, don't you? This guy believes in fair trade, though often he will go way beyond that and pay a fair price for beans. And he also believes in everything organic. And so from Zotter I have what has been called by a self-professed expert, but many people do admire his book, Georg Bernardini, who helped the Academy judge last year, what he calls the best milk chocolate in the world. Well, you may not like milk chocolate, you may totally disagree with him. I actually adore this stuff, but there we go. Nicaragua, 50% cocoa solids, so theoretically still a dark milk. A very, very smooth chocolate. It's what Zotto does extremely well, it's a very smooth chocolate. He's also a crazy, crazy inventive guy. I wish I had time to go through the presentation. We can just see it running in the background. I've visited, it's a most astounding place. It is a real Neverland. And here we have something for Christmas, and I suggest you kind of take it home with you, unless you want to try it with one of those wood-softened spirits. And this is a Nashido bar filled with wood kindling. This is dark chocolate, and it's got a wood kindling cream inside it. I mean, this guy distills the most crazy, crazy things. He has a graveyard of failed ideas, you won't be surprised to know. And he has 365 ideas on the go every year, as it is. Quite separately from Pump Street, a previous Gold Academy Award winner, we have a rye, milk and salt. And this was partly as a request from Sarah Jane saying, oh, Madeira, salt it, salt, milk, maybe. And we have two Gold Award winning chocolates here from Rococo. And this one, again, you might try with the Madeira, is a honey, caramel and salt. And this one, previous year's winner, that one a gold last this year. And previous year, one of my great, great, probably my favourite full chocolate in the world is a calamansi caramel from Rococo. And these will feature in their Christmas box as well. And last but not least, to go with that vodka, which you might leave to last, danger of falling down the stairs when you go back, is from Hotel Chocolat, which I'll look in a moment, a salted espresso martini made with that vodka. Chocolate. So now have a glorious time. We'll set out the drinks and come and taste. Everything's identified here.
First of all, I just want to thank Sylvia because I think you can tell from the way she's been talking that she's been very engaged with this. And without Sylvia, we wouldn't have the Chocolate Academy Awards and your closeness with the award winners.
Oh, thank you.
So thank you to Sylvia.
Get some drink out.